The general reaction for an SN2 reaction looks a lot like the reaction for an SN1. We start with an alkyl halide, and we add to that a nucleophile and a solvent, and the nucleophile substitutes for our halogen in the final product. The difference between an SN1 and SN2 reaction comes in the mechanism. So let's look at the details of the mechanism for SN2. So in an SN2 reaction, the bond between the carbon and the halogen is polarized, right? The halogen is more electronegative than the carbon over here, so it pulls the electrons in this bond closer to itself, giving the halogen a partial negative charge like that. If this carbon over here is losing electron density, right, it's going to end up being partially positively charged. So when the nucleophile comes along, right, so here's our nucleophile, we'll make it negatively charged, it is going to be attracted to the partial positively charged carbon over here. So the nucleophile is going to attack this carbon. And this attack happens before the halogen leaves. It actually happens at the same time. So usually SN2 reactions require a strong nucleophile. Okay, so that's one difference between SN1 and SN2. So let's go ahead and draw the transition state as to what's happening. So as the nucleophile attacks our carbon, right? So as the nucleophile attacks our carbon and is in the process of forming a bond, right, that's when our halogen leaves. So the halogen leaves at the same time, right? So let me go ahead and draw a partial bond in here for our halogen as well, like that. So this is our transition state, right? This is our SN2 transition state. The bond between the nucleophile and the carbon is forming at the same time the bond between the carbon and the halogen is breaking. And notice how the nucleophile has to attack from the opposite side of the halogen. Okay, so that's the only place where it can attack. The halogen's in the way over here on the right, so there's no way that the nucleophile can attack from the right for this example. The nucleophile has to attack from the left, the opposite side of your leaving group. And because of that, when your leaving group finally does leave, right, the same time that you form a bond between the carbon and the nucleophile, you get only inversion of configuration, right? So only inversion. So that's the difference from SN1, right? You get only inversion here. So you can see how we started with our halogen on the right over here, and our nucleophile ended up from the left. That's the only product from this SN2 reaction. And why do we call it SN2, right? S stands for substitution, N stands for nucleophilic, so our nucleophile is substituting. And it is the 2 comes in the fact that it's bimolecular, so SN2, substitution, nucleophilic, bimolecular, meaning the overall rate of this reaction depends on the concentration of 2 of our reactants. It depends on the concentration of both our nucleophile and our alkyl halide, right? So if I were to write the rate law for this mechanism, the overall rate of the reaction would be equal to the rate constant K times the concentration of your starting alkyl halide times the concentration of your nucleophile. Right, so that's why it is called an SN2 reaction, because to get to this transition state, obviously you would need your nucleophile and your halogen. So that's different from an SN1. Remember, in an SN1 reaction, the rate depended only on the concentration of our alkyl halide. So let's look at a problem here, and let's see how an SN2 mechanism and stereochemistry are involved for an actual reaction. So let's start with this right here. So our alkyl halide, I'll put a methyl group here. I'll put an ethyl group coming out at us, so CH2, CH3, and then going away from us, I'll put a hydrogen like that. So we're going to react this alkyl halide with sodium hydroxide, all right, so Na plus OH minus. So let's go ahead and name our alkyl halide first, right? So let's see how many carbons are in my alkyl halide over here. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4. Right, with a bromine coming off of carbon 2, so it'd be 2-bromobutane, right? So 2-bromobutane, like that. And you have to think about stereochemistry here, right? This is a chirality center, right? This carbon right here is a chirality center. So let's assign a priority to the groups attached to our chirality center, right? Well, bromine gets 1, right? The ethyl group gets 2, methyl group gets 3. The hydrogen's going away from us, it gets a 4, so we can ignore it, and we can see that, right, we're going around this way. right? So that is counterclockwise. That's the S absolute configuration. So S2-bromobutane would be the IUPAC name for this molecule. Now we think about our SN2 mechanism, right? And we identify the group that's going to leave eventually, and that, of course, is the bromine right here. And so that's our leaving group eventually. Our nucleophile would be our negatively charged anion. In this case, is our hydroxide anion. So our hydroxide is going to attack our carbon, and because the bromine isn't going to leave yet in the mechanism, the OH has to attack from the opposite side of the bromine, right? So the OH has to go all the way over here to attack our chirality center, our carbon, like that. So let's go ahead and draw the transition state, right, for this mechanism, right? So the OH is going to be forming a bond, right, with that carbon. At the same time, the bromine is going to be leaving, so we draw these partial bonds here, right? And the stereochemistry of everything else stays the same, right? So we'll go ahead and put our ethyl group here, put our hydrogen going away from us, and put our methyl group going down like that. So this would be the transition state. The bond between the OH and the carbon is forming at the same time the bromine is leaving. So when that happens, right, when the bromine finally leaves, when these electrons finally kick off onto your bromine like that, the OH would end up on the left side. So let's go ahead and draw that. Okay, so our OH, right, our carbon is bonded to the OH, and it added on to the left side. And once again, we just keep the ethyl group as a wedge, right? We keep the hydrogen as a dash, and we keep the methyl group, right, with a straight line. So the bond is in the plane of the page. Let's go ahead and name our product, even though we haven't done alcohol nomenclature, right? There's still four carbons, of course. 1, 2, 3, 4, and the OH group is coming off of carbon 2, so we call it 2-butanol. Right, so this is 2-butanol. What is the absolute configuration at our chirality center, right? What is the absolute configuration at this carbon right here? So once again, we assign priority, right? Oxygen has the highest atomic number, so it gets the highest priority. Ethyl group, then our methyl group, then our hydrogen, so we don't worry about that. So we're going around this way. We're going around clockwise. So that would, of course, be R. So we get R2-butanol as our product. And so you can see we get only inversion of configuration. We started off with S2-bromobutane, right, and we end up with R. So we got inversion of configuration, and this is our only product, right, if this reaction proceeds via an SN2 mechanism. Let's do the exact same problem again, and this time let's draw it out how you would see it on a test, right? You most likely wouldn't see it this way on a test. That was just to show you the mechanism and why you get inversion of configuration, right? So let's see if we could do it again. All right, so I'm trying to draw S2-bromobutane, right? So S2-bromobutane should look like that. And so on an exam, you would see your molecule like this, and then you would see Na plus OH minus, and we'll talk about how to determine SN1 versus SN2 in the next few videos. For right now, just assume it's an SN2 reaction mechanism. So once again, right, you identify your leaving group, you identify your nucleophile, and if you know this is an SN2 reaction, you know that hydroxide anion has to attack this carbon from the opposite side of the bromine, right? So when this OH, right, acts as a nucleophile and attacks this carbon right there, it would have to attack from the opposite side of the bromine. So the bromine is going to leave, and the OH is going to form a bond. And since we had the bromine as a wedge there, we would have to have the OH as a dash, because that's on the opposite side. So we get inversion of configuration for our products, right? So hopefully that's R2-butanol on the right there. So go ahead and assign absolute configurations, and you can see that you get only inversion of configuration for an SN2 reaction. All right, let's look at one more thing in this video. Let's look at the effect of the structure of your alkyl halide, and let's see what effect that structure has in the overall rate of your reaction, because it makes a big difference. All right, so let's look at two molecules here. So let's look at two alkyl halides. So let's say this is one alkyl halide. So I'll go ahead and put a methyl group here, and I'll go ahead and put the hydrogens on there like that. And then down here, I'll just put hydrogens. Okay, so that's one possible alkyl halide. All right, if you were to classify that alkyl halide in terms of structure, what would you call it? All right, this carbon right here attached to my halogen, how many carbons is that attached to? It's attached to one other carbon. Therefore, this is a primary alkyl halide, like that. All right, let's draw another alkyl halide. So we'll try to make it very similar here, and we'll put a methyl group up here like this. All right, the difference is down here, instead of hydrogens, we're going to have methyl groups. So methyl group coming out at us, a methyl group going away from us, so something like that. And how would you classify this alkyl halide, right? So let's get some more room here. So once again, this is the carbon attached to my halogen. How many carbons is that carbon attached to? 1, 2, 3, making this a tertiary alkyl halide. So let's say these two alkyl halides were undergoing an SN2 reaction. We would draw our nucleophile, forming a bond with our carbon. Right, so our nucleophile would be attacking right here, our nucleophile would be attacking right here, right? The halogen hasn't left yet, right? It would become a partial bond. And I think to myself, which one of these two structures would it be the easiest for the nucleophile to attack? And the answer is, of course, it's easiest for the nucleophile to attack in the example on the left, right? Because there's not as much stuff in the way, right? This methyl group right here might sterically hinder this nucleophile a little bit, but these hydrogens down here are small, and therefore it's easier for the nucleophile to get in to attack that carbon. Over here on the right, I have a big methyl group up here, and I also have a bulky methyl group down here, right? You can see sterically, it's much harder for our nucleophile to get in there to form a bond with our carbon. So there's more steric hindrance for the example on the right. So, right, so let me go ahead and write that increased steric hindrance for the molecule on the right. And therefore, the molecule on the right is not as likely to undergo an SN2 reaction mechanism. So therefore, the least sterically hindered alkyl halide favors SN2 mechanism, right? And a strong nucleophile also favors an SN2 mechanism, since that allows it to get in there to form a bond easier with that carbon. So decreased steric hindrance favors SN2. Therefore, if I were to rank the order of reactivity in terms of rate via an SN2 mechanism, right, a methyl alkyl halide would have the least steric hindrance, so that would be the fastest reacting via an SN2 mechanism. Primary alkyl halide, like our example up here, also there's not a lot of stuff in the way, so that's also going to react via an SN2 reaction mechanism. That reacts much faster than a secondary alkyl halide, which reacts much, much faster than a tertiary alkyl halide according to an SN2 mechanism. So think about steric hindrance when you're trying to figure out if a reaction is SN1 or SN2, which again, the next few videos will be devoted exclusively to that concept.